Good morning and welcome to our service of worship and celebration on this 4th of July weekend here at the Little Home Church by the Wayside in Wayne, Illinois. Congratulations to our new council, and thank you to every member of the congregation for getting your vote in to elect them. They are ready to take office and get going on the work ahead for our congregation this year. We want to welcome back the Reverend Jim Benzing, who has preached for us once before on camera, and we're glad to have him here again today. And finally, our soloist this morning, Nick, we want to wish a very fond farewell to. He will be starting his master's degree in vocal performance at the University of Illinois this fall. Nick has been a member of our church choir for the last 2.5 years, and we look forward to hosting him through the holidays when he's home and next summer. Finally, please consider becoming a YouTube subscriber. And if you want to know more about our church, visit the website, which you'll see on the screen at the end of the service.
Please join me in the call to worship. Jesus says, "Come to me, everyone. When I play a joyful tune, we'll dance. When I sing a lament, we'll weep. When I chant for justice, we'll sing along." Invocation and confession. Come to us, Holy One, and immerse us in the beauty of life with you. Come to us, Holy One, and enliven our community with the intensity of your love. Come to us, Holy One, and embolden our community with the urgency of your justice. In the name of the one who calls us to play and to work in community, Jesus, our beloved. I know that all God's commands are spiritual, but I'm not. I decide one way, but then I act another, doing things I absolutely despise. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to be bad, but then I do it anyway. I truly delight in God's commands, but the power of sin sabotages my best intentions. I've tried everything. Who can help me? Hear these words of assurance. The answer, thank God, is that Jesus Christ can and does help us. He acted to set things right in this life of contradictions, where I want to serve God with all my heart and mind, but am pulled by the influence of sin to do something totally different. He calls us, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy burdened. I will share your yoke and make it light. I will lead in the way you desire to travel." Amen. Hello, boys and girls. For today's children's sermon, I'm going to share with you a poem by Langston Hughes. I thought of this poem as we celebrate July 4th. The poem is called, "I Too Am America." I Too Am America by Langston Hughes illustrated by Bryan, Collier. I, too, sing America. I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes. But I laugh and eat well and grow strong. Tomorrow I'll be at the table when company comes. Nobody'll dare say to me, eat in the kitchen then. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I, too, am America. And now, let's fold our hands together and say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In our worship service where we actively and intentionally take part in the support of the ministry of Christ. If you are a member of Little Home Church, we encourage you to continue your pledges and financial support. And if you are visiting with us today, we welcome your gifts as well. You may donate by Venmo, PayPal, or by sending a check into the church office through the mail. The information is on the screen. The treasure of God's glory is Jesus shining in our hearts. We hold this treasure in the earthen vessels of our lives. Let us share freely of the gifts we have been given, that the glory of God may be known in the works of community, justice, and peace. Amen. Our scripture readings today start with Psalm 145, verses 8 through 14. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. The kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. And from Matthew chapter 11, verses 16 through 19. But to what will I compare this generation? Is it like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another? We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. And from Matthew 11, verses 25 through 30. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning. It is so good to see all your bright and smiling faces again. And yes, you all know, I'm sure, that Lori has put cutouts of your faces in the pews. You're all in the same spots you were last time. So like most churches, we have our favorite seats. I've always had one in the front. So what can I say about that? Anyways, I'm in my what I consider summer mode of preaching. That's no robe with just the stole. I found that even the best air-conditioned churches can be very warm with those robes on, so I forego them for the summer. And to be honest with me, some of you are at home in shorts and t-shirts or just sitting around still in your bathrobes, so we can all be a little comfortable on this 4th of July weekend, and I hope you've had a safe and enjoyable one and have enjoyed this week and weekend as we celebrate our country and all that it means to us. Let us pray. Dear God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and souls be acceptable unto you this day. Amen. Well, there's an organization in South Korea that discovered a novel way to help people deal with their stress. This organization stages living funerals. Now, again, you heard me right, living funerals. Now, participants at living funerals write out a short testament of their last thoughts and wishes. Then they put on a funeral shroud and lie down in a closed coffin for about 10 minutes. The purpose of these living funerals, which is a free service offered by the Hyalin Healing Center, is to help people gain a new perspective on life. The director of the Healing Center says that some people have reconciled with family or friends after their living funeral. Others have changed careers. Some participants who were contemplating suicide credit their living funeral with changing their minds. The purpose of the living funeral, according to the director, is to realize that happiness is in the present. Happiness is in the present. Most of us would agree with that, but many of us do not live like that. All too often, many of us describe our lives as busy, hectic, even crazy. That seems to be the norm. No one has any time anymore. No one gets any rest. Finish this sentence. I'll sleep when I'm blank. Now, some people answer with the word dead. I'll sleep when I'm dead. Might that not be too late? In our Bible passage today, Jesus challenges the people around him with these words. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Now, Jesus is saying to us that weariness is not meant to be our normal way of living. That's not what God created us for. In fact, no matter how productive our out-of-control schedule makes us feel, it is actually living in opposition to the rhythms of life. The rhythms of life that contribute to peace, clarity, and purposeful living. Weariness and burdens blind us to the true purpose of our lives and bind us with a sense of powerlessness. They isolate us. When you are weary and burdened, your focus narrows to what is right in front of you, to what is urgent, instead of what is important. This behavior is the norm in our culture, so we don't question it. That's just the way life is. Except that Jesus says it isn't the way things are meant to be. So what did Jesus mean by rest for our souls? I read recently about another group devoted to giving us rest. However, this one's a business. In 2005, a store called Mini Napolis opened in Minnesota's Mall of America. Now notice the name, Mini Napolis. For 70 cents a minute, tired shoppers can rent a soundproof room for napping. The rooms have special themes like deep space, Asian mist, and tropical isle. Or if you don't feel like napping, you can sit in the store's massage chair, gaze at a waterfall, listen to soft music, and breathe in the positive ionization filtered air. The owners of the store advertised it as an enjoyable escape from the fast-paced lifestyle. Well, some people probably find that helpful. However, rest for our souls is not the same thing as a nap, a vacation, or breathing in positive ionization-filtered air while gazing at a fake waterfall. It's not a temporary respite from our stress. Rest for our souls is a reorientation of our values and perceptions of life to match up with the values and perceptions of God, the one who created us, the source of our being. Listen to Jesus' words again. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Well, the first thing that Jesus is saying to us, you have a soul. Or to be more accurate, we are a soul. We are more than the cells that make us up. We have an inner being that was created with the image of God within us, that puts the imprint of the eternal, all-powerful God Almighty within you. Your soul, your inner being, is a mark of God's abundant love for you. It marks you as incredibly valuable in God's eyes. Which leads us to a question. Are you experiencing life the way God meant you to experience it? Or do you feel weary and burdened because you are living in a way that is disconnected from your soul, from that inner being, from that image of God within you? Mike Jaffe was a young, successful businessman working for a Fortune 500 company. In his mid-30s, he began to realize that he wasn't fulfilled in his work. He was neglecting his family. He felt disconnected from any great purpose in his life. Every morning, Mike's wife would drive him to the train station for his two-hour commute to New York City. Their one-year-old daughter slept in the back seat on the way to the station. Mike worried that he rarely saw his daughter when she was awake, and his wife was practically a single parent. His success at work wasn't making a meaningful difference in the world. His life was so hectic, he barely had time to think. But all of Mike's colleagues and friends lived like this as well. Who was he to think that life could be any different? Well, then it happened. One morning, Mike decided that he would stay home and eat breakfast with his wife and daughter and take the late train to work. But to him, this was a huge sacrifice. All his colleagues came in early and stayed late. He couldn't afford to stand out. But he was just so tired of being controlled by his job and missing out on his family. That morning, Mike and his wife and daughter had a great time eating breakfast together and chatting about their week. Mike took the late train to the office. Now, because of this one decision to reconnect with his family, Mike Jaffe was not in his office, which was at the North Tower of the World Trade Center on September 11, 2001. He wasn't there when the first plane slammed into the building. His life was spared by a simple decision one morning to spend some time with his family. Mike Jaffe has written a book about the tragedy of losing his friends and colleagues in the September 11th attack. It's titled, Wake Up! Your Life is Calling. He says his mission now is to be a human wake-up call, to convince people to live meaningful lives that don't revolve around society's definition of success. Well, Jesus is the ultimate wake-up call for us. for our souls, for our inner beings. Listen to some other statements that Jesus made about this. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Jesus cares about our soul, our inner being, our lives, because he knows that we are a reflection of God's image within us. So I'll ask the question again. Are you weary and burdened because you're living in a way that is disconnected from God? And with that, we have a Savior. We have a bridge between us and God. Jesus did not say, "Come to me, and all your troubles will go away." He said, "Come to me, and I'll share your life. You won't be alone anymore." That's what he said when he said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." Jesus lived every moment knowing that there are certain things worth living and dying for, and everything else is just noise. We have a Savior, we have a friend who understands what we're facing. Jesus knows what it's like to be tired. He knows what it's like to be lonely and misunderstood. He knows what it's like to put your heart and soul into a mission and not see any results. You have a Savior, you have a friend who chose to live as we live, as a human being, so he could show us our identity, our purpose, our strength, and our hope aren't based on our circumstances. They are based on the reality of a loving God living within us. Let me tell you about a young boy named Caleb. Caleb was diagnosed with a nervous system disease that left him for a time with temporary paralysis. Now one day, Caleb's dad came to visit him at school, and from a distance, he watched as 5-year-old Caleb limped across the playground. And Caleb's father was heartbroken to see the other kids playing all around his son, games in which Caleb couldn't participate. But then he saw Caleb's best friend, Tyler, come up to Caleb. Now, Tyler could have been off with the other kids, running and jumping and playing. But Tyler chose to walk slowly alongside Caleb for the rest of recess. Tyler didn't take away Caleb's burdens. He simply walked with him and loved him in his weakness. Well, Jesus does the same thing for us. And having that love and power freely available to us makes any burden easier to bear. Take my yoke upon you. We have a soul, an inner being, and we have a Savior. We have, as the song says, a friend in Jesus. And finally, Jesus is saying to us in this passage, we have a solution to our weariness and burdens. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In the 1970s movie and in the subsequent remake, Freaky Friday, a frustrated mother and a rebellious daughter suddenly exchange lives. The mother wakes up in the daughter's body and vice versa. And each one has to live a few days with the priorities, responsibilities, and stresses of the other. And so mother and daughter learn to respect and empathize with each other because they've walked in each other's shoes. If Jesus were to live a day in your life, would he have the same priorities as you do? Would he view your circumstances as you do? Would he get stressed over the things that stress you out? Well, why not? Because Jesus looks beyond the circumstances of our lives to the greater story that a loving God is writing through us. I want to tell you about a woman named Rose who has experienced unbelievable stress in her life. Stress that should put our anxieties into perspective. Rose is a woman in Rwanda who lost most of her family to the Rwanda genocide of 1994. Rose and her two daughters survived the attacks. How does Rose deal with the shock and grief of witnessing such carnage when she lost members of her own family? She explained it this way. For this I have Jesus. For this I have Jesus. And from there, she's adopted orphans from these attacks. She's done other things to reach out to others and help them. What has inspired her? For this, I have Jesus. What other source of peace or rest are you counting on besides Jesus? This life can take so much away from us. But there is a part of us that cannot be taken away. It is not affected by outward circumstances or inward doubts. It's that eternal stamp on your personhood. An eternal stamp that says you were made with the image of God in you, and God loves you so much that God came in the form of Jesus to share your life and to die for you. Come to Jesus and submit your life to his guidance and his priorities, and you will find rest for your soul. That's the solution. You decide, will you keep on living in a way that is disconnected from your inner being, from that image of God in you? Or will you live from the perspective and priorities of a soul that is created with God's image in you? Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. For this we have Jesus. Amen. Let us come together for a time of prayer. Lord, we have many names for you. Spirit, Father, Mother, Eternal God, Jehovah. But names do not cause us to know you. We want communion with you. We want more than speaking about you. We believe that you have made us with your image in us to experience your love. We remember your promises, that if we seek you, we will find you, that if we gather in your name, you will be present, that you will come to us and abide with us. We want these promises to be fulfilled. We want the assurance that you are for real. We want the experience of your guiding us. We want the evidence that you are near us. We have seen something of you in the world of nature, in the kindness of others, in the words of Scripture, in the inspiration of worship. But we want to know you in any fullness and power that we may have yet to experience. If there are avenues of awareness we have not explored, lead us down those new roads where we will discover greater dimensions of your reality. Will we ever be satisfied with our knowledge of you? Do you keep us searching? Is it your will that we see through a glass darkly in anticipation of new levels of living where we will fully understand? If that is your purpose, we will never cease in the search to experience all that you disclose of yourself. In the name of the one who loves us this day and forevermore. Amen. Let us depart this day, knowing for this we have Jesus. Let us depart in that assurance this day in the love of God, the Heavenly Parent, Jesus, our always with us friend, and the ever-present and powerful Holy Spirit. Let us go forth in peace this day and always. Amen.
Troubles to the child.